suppose the main thing I want to say is I think that we can make a difference, and we can do some very important things which are going to impact into the future of this generation of children in our schools in Ireland today and for all time. We've heard from Brian the view from the level of the university, and we've heard from James the outsider's view of the education system. But I want to tell you a story about the how Educate Together came to be. And it started with a small group of parents who felt alienated from our education system and excluded and unable to find equality of esteem for their children in the education system at the time. And as a group of ordinary people getting together, people from different backgrounds, people who may well have not chosen each other to share a pint in the pub, but came together for the benefit of their children and really sat down to try and see what it was, what type of education should look like, and what it should be for the needs of their children at that time. We're going back 35 years, but the lesson is that people who sit down and think and try and plan and look at fundamental issues can create things which make enormous differences to whole systems. The group of people who established the Educate Together model started with four very simple principles. First of all, that children coming into a school should never be treated unequally, never be discriminated against, never should feel excluded or an outsider on account of their background. Children don't choose the accident of their birth and should not suffer as a result of it in any system of education or any system produced by a modern, responsible, democratic state. So the principles on which the Educate Together model started was, first of all, that principle of equality of esteem to children, irrespective of their social, cultural, or religious backgrounds. They also said that the education system should be based on the actual needs of the children in schools. Shouldn't be based on external needs of society or curricula. It should be actually based on what children need to learn in those schools at that time, in real time. They also recognized that in schools we should have to break the barrier between family and the house and the home and school, that they knew that what happens in a child's home is actually the primary determinant of their educational development. And starting from those principles, they developed a model against enormous difficulties, enormous vested interests, laying obstacles in their path. And today, 35 years later, they created a network of 65 primary schools educating 16,000 pupils. And despite the fact that the national organization running this network only gets around 11% of its funding from the state, that network now controls well over 100 million euros worth of state current expenditure in the education system on an annual basis. Today, that movement is now moving with the help of passionate, forward-thinking educational innovators such as Brian McGrath and others, to really address the same issue that pertains to our second level system. Our second level system still is an instrument whereby our society filters access to its most valuable and rich occupations and professions, and does so by the imposition of a narrow academic series of tests, and in particular by a week and a half marathon of longhand writing, a skill which no child will ever have to repeat at any time in its future life. I don't have a problem with handwriting, by the way. I'm a great fan of handwriting. Handwriting in the modern world is an art form which you use for personal notes and very short communications. And it is not the way in which we decide who should be dentists, who should be doctors, who should be scientists, and to exclude those who don't have that particular skill. Our education system currently is a system which still is orientated culturally and organizationally around an exclusionary principle. And it excludes the wide range of human abilities which are not reflected by narrow, rote-learned tests and a narrow academic exam system. This is something that we have to change. What we have learned is the fundamental requirement for this generation of children in schools today is the question of confidence, the question of recognition of their own identity. They have to, as children, be recognized, respected, equally and supported and nourished in the education system in such a way as they have the confidence and skills to ask the right questions, to work collaboratively, to work with others, to question, to be able to approach authority in an appropriate way so that the questions are asked and that we do not have the type of society which allows the huge deficits of responsibility that we have experienced ourselves in terms of our banking, political and financial systems. That's what we have to do. What I would like to pose to you is, and ask for your help, is that we have two huge issues in our education system. First of all, we still, as a modern democratic state in the year 2013, we still require many families to send their children to schools, to religious schools, against their lawful preference and their conscience. This is something which is unsustainable, unpardonable, and totally inconsistent with our respect for human rights and for the rights of children in our schools, in our education system, and in the rights of minorities in our society. We have to move to a situation in which no child has to be sent to a school which by law has to uphold a particular religious viewpoint against their identity of their families. This is something which has to happen. A network of schools to provide that choice has to be created. We believe that by creating a network of choice, we can also create a network of challenge. And that is that we can create a mechanism whereby innovation, change, the exploration of new approaches, the exploration of new ways of providing assessment of the full value and the full range of human abilities can be achieved. The second thing that we have to do is to push forward a reform in our second level system and to bring forward the type of dispositions and skills which Brian and also James has pointed out. The idea that we have to have integrated subjects, we have to have collaborative learning environments, we have to allow people to work together. Currently, if children collaborate in their Leaving Cert, they're thrown out as cheats, whereas in every field of life that we know, the critical change makers are small groups of people who work together in order to bring about change, in order to create new products, in order to take responsibility for the type of social and economic problems which society takes. I would like to ask you to join with us to make these two major essential changes to our education system. I'm delighted that Educate Together Now will be announcing a strategic partnership with Dublin City University very soon, and that Dublin City University has agreed to work with us to evaluate our radical new approach to second level education, which will take place with our first three second level schools, which will open next September, in September 2014. But I'd like to just finish that this generation of children today, this entire generation who bears no responsibility whatsoever for the financial difficulties, the political and bureaucratic crises which our society is embroiled in. As we struggle to get out of the mire of that crisis, we have to insist that out of that comes a society which really prioritises learning, that sees the opportunity of reform in our education system as a huge strategic obligation for this generation of children. And I think if we can, not only will we serve them well, but we may well be able to become a beacon to education in the world, and maybe to make a serious contribution to international education as well. So thank you very much.